The story that you told yourself about your life, the story that in a way became your prison. Maybe you realize that you can set yourself free from this story.
Herzlich willkommen zu Hansa Rauschen, dem Literaturpodcast des Hansa Verlages. Mein Name ist Florian Kessler. Hier sprechen alle zwei Wochen Lektorinnen und Lektoren mit Menschen aus der Welt der Bücher, mit Schreibenden und Lesenden, mit Leuten von anderen Verlagen und aus dem Haus. Es geht um alles, was in Bücher passt und außenrum passiert. Und das ist wirklich nicht wenig.
Jetzt gerade in diesem August erscheint bei Hansa der neue Roman von David Grossmann, Was Nina wusste. Der 1954 in Jerusalem geborene David Grossmann schreibt Romane, Kinderbücher und politische Essays und erhielt viele internationale Preise, darunter auch den Friedenspreis des Deutschen Buchhandels. Schon 1988 erschien bei Hansa der Roman Das Lächeln des Lammes. Von den späteren Büchern sollen zumindest Der Kindheitserfinder, Eine Frau flieht vor einer Nachricht und zuletzt der mit dem Man Booker International Prize ausgezeichnete Roman Kommt ein Pferd in die Bar erwähnt sein, sowie die Essaybände Die Kraft der Korrektur und Aus der Zeit fallen. David Grossmanns Bücher werden von Anne Birkenhauer übersetzt. Im Lektorat betreut sie über die Jahrzehnte hinweg Tatjana Michaelis. Für Hansa Rauschen hat Tatjana mit David Grossmann nicht wie sonst so oft über Handy, Festnetz oder E-Mail kommuniziert, sondern ein großes Gespräch per Zoom geführt. Es geht um David Grossmanns Erfahrungen in Israel mit der Corona-Krise, um seine weiteren Pläne und vor allem um sein neues Buch. Wie ist Grossmann auf die Geschichte von Was Nina wusste gekommen? Was hat ihn an dieser besonderen, großen, tragischen Familiengeschichte so sehr fasziniert, dass er sie auf seine eigene Weise erzählen musste? Viel Spaß mit Hansa Rauschen.
Dear David, welcome to this Hansa podcast, Hansa Rauschen. I am so happy that today we can meet on Zoom and have this conversation. How is the situation with the coronavirus now in Israel? Are you living under restrictions? Can you see your father and your grandchildren?
Yes, actually, I'll start from the end, which maybe is the most important. We can see the little ones, our granddaughters, and we do see them quite often. And I can see my parents, even though they live in a home for elderly people and we are not allowed to go in because the elders are so vulnerable and frail.
Yeah.
So we meet, you know, with the masks on our faces, and it's all full of restrictions, small restrictions, how many people are allowed to be in a restaurant in the inner room and how in the outer room. No cinemas, of course, until now, no theater plays. It's accumulation of forbiddings.
Yeah.
That step by step makes life a little gloomy. And I think we all feel it. I think in a way, I get the impression that most of the people I meet are in a kind of a silent depression because of being deprived all the time, step by step, from things that made our life better and happier. And now we have less and less and less. And I hope it'll stop somewhere with the vaccination against the corona.
I remember that in March you commented on the outbreak of the virus. You called it a worldwide defeat, a disaster of biblical scale. I was much more optimistic at the time, I must admit, but it turned out you were right. What do you think today?
Well, it's always pay off to be more pessimistic, unfortunately.
Yeah.
Always, you have more chance to be right. What I think of the situation today, even the word situation is cannot be accurate because it's a very fluid situation. Everything changes and from day to day. We cannot predict. The virus is so unpredictable and he does not yield to the research until now. Maybe now it will change because in Israel and in United States, some laboratories come up with some interesting achievements. But all in all, I think the main feeling is of uncertainty. The feeling
yes.
that the earth is moving under our feet. I guess many people after the corona will look back at their life and maybe they will make new decisions regarding their jobs, if they have any, maybe regarding their couplehood, maybe regarding other things. It's also, you know, besides the catastrophe, it's also a chance to rearticulate where you are in life and what you can do and what you want to do and what would like to achieve. So it is, well, everything we shall say about the corona is a cliche because, as Albert Camus wrote in his book, the plague is bigger than us. We are standing very small in front of it.
So let's talk about your new novel, What Nina Knew, Was Nina Wusste. How did this story come to you?
It's a funny story. One day the phone rang and a lady with a very decisive and ordering voice was on the other side. And she told me, David, she had this very high-pitched voice. And immediately I stood upright and felt guilty for something. And I said, yes. And she introduced herself. Her name was Eva Panic Nahir. And she said she came from ex-Yugoslavia, from a Jewish family. And she had something, she wanted to criticize something I wrote in the newspaper of that day. And then we started to talk, and immediately I felt that she is a very, very unique human being. Now, every human being is unique, as you know, Tatiana, but she was unique in a uniquer way.
Okay.
And she had a wonderful, wonderful, tragic, but so extreme story, life story. And she started to tell me about herself, but then after some minutes, she cut it, and she asked whether she can call me in another time in the future, you know, like Sherazade, making me wanting to know the rest of the story.
And you only met by telephone? No.
In the beginning, yes.
In the beginning, yes.
Step by step, she told me her story, but again, only with bits and pieces, enough to tempt me and to make me attracted very much to the rest of the story. And then she came to Jerusalem and we met, and I came to her place where she lived in a kibbutz, Shar HaMakim, and we became really very, very good friends. We were very good friends and very close for the last 20 years of her life. She died 5 years ago when she was 97. One of the most unusual people I have ever met. Also because of the combination she had, she was a very tough ideologist, communist ideologist, very tough, very hermetic, very fanatic when it came to her principles. Yet when it came to everyday life and to being with people, she was so easygoing and so warm and so empathetic and so full of love. Really, the combination was very unusual.
Yes. And when you decided to write a book based on her story, did she or her family impose any rules or restrictions to you?
No, not at all. Her family, and now I got to know most of them, and they are really a wonderful family. And Eva herself, and later her daughter Tiana, told me very, very clearly, you are an artist. Take this story and do with it whatever you want. And I said to Eva, I told her, listen, I'm not a documentarist. I will not write your story one-to-one. I'm a fiction writer. I must invent you. I must fantasize you. I must imagine you even though I know you. And she said, of course. And I said, listen, sometimes it might be painful because I will see you and write about you from angles of yourself that you prefer not to know or that you prefer not to speak about. But I will have to do it because it is there. I witness it. And if I witness it, I want to write it. And she said, my story is yours. And so I did it. I'm sorry she did not read the book before she died. From time to time, she asked me, though, have you started writing my book? And I said, no, Eva. I she knew me. I cannot decide to write a book. The book has to impose itself on me. And the reasons for these imposures, I don't know. But one day, a book is inevitable. And this is how I want to write. I want to write my books when they are inevitable, not when I choose to write them. And then after she died, I think a year and a half after she died, then suddenly I felt I must write the book of Eva and her family and her daughter.
Let us just stop a moment on Vera, the fictional character. She is in the center of the book. And we learn that she did something horrible to her daughter, Nina. She left her behind when Nina was a child. And the novel reveals step by step what exactly happened. I do not spoil it. But on the other hand, we see Vera swaddling a baby just in the beginning of the book. And she has been a wonderful mother to her stepson, Rafi. And she is wonderful with her granddaughter, Gili. So I think she's a highly interesting, very complex person. Can you characterize her briefly?
I tried before I told about the contradictions. I think the extremity is what fascinated me, the extremity of everything she did, of her ideology dimension, ideological dimension, and about her humane and warmth dimension. Her granddaughter in my story wrote about her that she's undefinable. She said it's like Little Red Hood with the wolf in the same skin. Mm-hmm. Very sharp and very quick and very decisive. All the time when you were with her, you felt this energy of a very active, inwardly active human being who is afraid of nothing. She was really the most courageous person that I ever saw, and she faced almost executions and attempt to rape her and interrogation with torments. And she never failed. She never failed in all of those tests. She never, for example, gave up her friends who allegedly were against the regime. I never met people who had to stand such existential tests and survived them in the way she did, because after she came back from hell, from this extermination or rehabilitation island, she was not bitter, she was not afraid, she was not vengeful even. She understood, I think, that being all of these would minimize her life, would narrow her life, and she wanted to live. And she lived. She lived with all the intensity and all the power of vitality.
Yeah, but the novel is not told by her. The novel is not told by Vera, but it is told by her granddaughter, Gili. Gili is writing all the time, taking notes for a documentary film she wants to do. Why did you choose her as the writer, the youngest voice?
I really hesitated, but I think it was a matter of first, which is the best, the most efficient point of view of the storyteller who will give the reader the most perspective gaze, look at the plot. And I think Gili is the one who is the least trapped within the family story. She is trapped because every one of these three women is trapped. And there is a secret that concerns all of them and is relevant to the three of them. But from the three, she is the most liberated. And it's also a question of language, because Nina, the mother of Gili, has a very functional language. She lives in the United States, then she moves to live in an island in the North Pole. But her language is not the main thing about her. And even her yearning to be cut away from life and not to be in contact with life, it shows itself in the language. Vera, Eva, in my story, she is called Vera. Vera has a very unique language. I never heard such a language from anyone. It's a mixture of German, of Hungarian, of Hebrew, maybe of English, and with a lot of idioms that she has invented and became the household idioms of all her family throughout the generations. She speaks a very broken Hebrew, yet it is also a Hebrew of a whole generation who came to Israel, let's say in the 40s and 50s from other countries, and used to be mocked at by their children, and their children even were ashamed on this strange language of their parents. And I got quite a few of reactions of people who thanked me for legitimizing this special dialect, the dialect of Vera, that when they were children, they were ashamed of, and now they see how it opens options when you speak in such a language. And the language carries with itself so much memories from other places, from being in other situations. But may I ask you, Tatiana,
yes.
how was it to edit? What were the decisions that you had to take in order to edit the language of Vera, of Eva?
I think it was quite difficult to translate this very special language. And the main thing was that it should not be something stupid, something narrow-minded, that all the wonderful personality of this Vera should be shown through this broken language. And this is a contradiction, but I think in the language it can become very productive.
Yeah, and I think we should thank here Anne Birkenauer.
Yes,
wonderful.
I think she did a wonderful job, and she was really conscious of the problem. The novel starts with Vera's birthday party. She is celebrating her 19th anniversary, and her granddaughter decides to make a documentary film about Vera and the secret of her life. So inside the novel, inside the narration, we find another medium, the film. Why did you choose this way of telling the story?
Because, first of all, because of the plot. In the plot, Nina knows that she is about to be sick and to lose her memory, to be dementic very soon. And she wants to keep things, to freeze some moments. I think maybe suddenly there is this echo of the past that echoes into the present and will echo maybe into the future. I think this is this what pushed me towards using the cameras. I like in almost every book of mine, I touch on another art. Yeah, it can be stand-up comedy, for example, in the last one. It can be poetry in another book. It can be a radio play. And I liked to think of the mixture between literature and the picture. What is more that is kept? What more do we remember? Do we remember in words or in images, in photos? I remember in words, for example. And yet, I think the reality is more clear through the photograph.
So you think the camera is a kind of lie detector? It helps to reveal the truth?
Also that, yes. Also that. I think it's very cruel in the way it can detect lies. But maybe it's also merciful, you know. It touches the human dimension in a merciful way, even when it's cruel.
Somewhere in the book, Gilly says that if you tell your story directly to the camera, maybe a trivial story, sometimes the story is cracking, something is changing. It seems that storytelling is not only important for you as an author, but it has also a strong significance for your protagonists.
Yes, again, I almost always tell about a person who tells a story to another person. And almost always, this story, which is a very relevant story for both of them, cracks them in a way. And suddenly they hear themselves. And if you tell your own story, even a story that you told for 100 times already, and you just declamate it or just quote the last time you told it, but if you have a good listener, a good midwife or midman to bring out the cliché of the story from inside you and melt it again, massage it again, then suddenly the story that you always told, the story that in a way became your prison, maybe you realize that you can set yourself free from this story, the story that you told yourself about your life from when you were a baby or a child and your parents did not understand you. And these old stories, these legislative stories, always have a kind of a power to impose themselves on us, and they congeal on us. And sometimes we do not pay attention to the fact that we have been really trapped by those legislative stories of us. And if you tell it again, if you tell it in new words, if you look at a given situation, but from another point of view, by the way, you can look at it from the point of view even of your enemy, if you want to write about the text of the political reality. If you have this ability to move, suddenly you are not a victim, a helpless victim of this story and of the circumstances of your life. And you are able really to set yourself free. It applies to the writer himself or herself. And it applies, of course, to the readers. And it also applies to the characters in the book, that suddenly they develop and there is something is opening up inside them, and they can move to another place, and maybe it's a better place.
Yes, it has a kind of liberating power. When Vera left her daughter Nina, the girl was 6 years old. Nina abandoned her daughter Gili when she was 3 and a half. Is there something like inherited guilt in the novel? I do not see it in a religious sense, but as a secular idea, a family trauma which you inherit.
Yes, I think you are right. The story is also about guilt. And the guilt goes in the family. And guilt is a destructive sensation, feeling, because it prevents you from doing something. You are trapped in this guilt. Or sometimes you only say, you know, I'm guilty of this and that, and after all, you just pay a lip service to guilt. You're not doing anything. And the guilt is like a heavy stone that blocks the mouth of the well. You say, yes, I'm guilty, and you don't go deeper. But if you go deeper, suddenly even your relationship with guilt can change, with your own guilt, but also with the guilt of your parents, for example. You know, sometimes we forget that even mama had a mama. Yes, we deprive our parents from the right to have a psychology. Only us have the right to have a psychology, they don't. And if you allow yourself not to accuse them and not to accuse yourself all the time, but try to understand why you did what you did and what were the implications and how they distorted you and how they trapped you, maybe also you will be liberated in a way, in a place that is so essential for you and became like a stiff muscle for all your life.
So the guilt has also spoiled the relationship between these three women, the Vera, the grandmother, and Nina, the mother, and Gili, the granddaughter. It is a very complex triangle. But then they do this journey to Croatia, to
Čakovec,
and to Goli Otok. And during their journey, I think there is a process starting. Is there some healing process during their trip?
I believe there is, as by the way it was in real life when they went to Goli Otok, the family. Eva and her daughter Tiana and her granddaughter Emily. And in my story, they are both afraid of opening up the wounds, and at the same time they realize it might be the last chance, because Eva is not very young anymore, she's 90 years old. It's the last chance, you know, to look reality in the eyes, and for the first time to say what really has happened and why each and every one of them behaved the way she behaved. Every one of them in the story, in my story, acts like both the daughter and the mother of the other woman. As you know, the human zone of women and their mothers is one of the most condensed and meaningful human zones. So much happened there, with so many nuances and inner contradictions. And I tried to bring them out of the three women. And by the way, they don't talk too much. They talk, but not too much, because every word is a password for some memory or some wound that they know. And the whole story is encapsulated and revealed at the same time.
There is a psychological damage, and this is it. It seems to be a private tragedy, but it is caused by politics, isn't it? Do you agree? It is the Tito dictatorship who has caused this tragedy.
Yeah, very much so. I think the brutality of the regime, and especially what happens in the camp of the women in Goli Otok. Life under fear, under constant accusation, under threats to be called a traitor and executed. The way people were programmed to regard every other human being, also other prisoners, as a potential enemy. In Goli Otok, everyone was the bad guy if he or she wanted to survive, maybe except of very, very few people. Amongst them was also Eva Nahir Panich, who did not betray, who did not give away any of her friends or accuse them. But I think that I would go to another political dimension of this story when Gili, who is photographing her mother, whom she deeply hated until the journey started. And suddenly when she takes her pictures, she sees her features, she sees her vulnerability, she sees her misery in life, and suddenly she feels compassion for her. And it confuses her, and she says, wow, maybe I'll stop hating her. Who am I without the hatred to Eva, to Vera? And I thought about this, the place of hatred in our life, in Israel, in the region, in our region. How we and the Palestinians are really now, after so many years of animosity, after 53 years of occupation, how we deeply hate each other. And it is to the extent that we don't know whom shall we be without the hatred towards each other. It defines so many layers and dimensions of our life. And it creates us in its shape. The hatred creates us. And we are eaten by hatred and by suspicion and by bitterness and by hopelessness and despair. Shall we be able to recognize ourselves without this when peace comes? And maybe peace does not come because we do not allow ourselves to give up on these bad qualities. Maybe we are prisoners of this story as well.
But these three women at least are able to see each other without that hatred, or with less hatred than they had at the beginning. Yes. I very much admire your psychological understanding of these women, not only because they are women and you are a man. I'm so impressed by your deep understanding of the human soul. Are you an expert in psychology or psychoanalysis?
Not at all. I'm married to one.
Yeah, I know.
Not because she's a psychologist, but because she's the person she is. And I have never been in a psychological treatment. I think I try to be totally tuned to a person when I write about him or her. Bereft myself, take off all the defense mechanisms, all the reasons for not being invaded by this other person, this other character. And I found out that, you know, usually we are very protected from each other, even couples who are very good couples, but they developed over the years the mechanism to protect them, not to be totally, totally exposed, totally dependent on the other. I don't say it's a good thing. I say it happens to couples. And of course, when we meet people, not only in the time of the corona, we are very suspicious. And of course, now we entrench like fists when we see a stranger. He might be our killer. But maybe something in us is yearning for the opposite, is yearning really to know other people without these walls of estrangement. Maybe if we allow ourselves to be invaded by some other people, we shall feel the points in ourselves that are only potential, that we never really explored them, that we never really allowed ourselves to go in the way that this character or that character suggests us.
Yeah, I think this is also what the novel is about, to overcome this estrangement from one from the other. And I think you are an expert in this kind of emotional trauma and finding appropriate literary expression for it. Unfortunately, I feel the end of our conversation approaching. Just one or two other questions. You are writing novels, children's and young adult books, and political essays. In which mood are you currently? What is your next project?
I don't know. In the Corona, I made a rule to myself to write only for children and to read only books that are older than me. To write only for children is for keeping the optimism, and to read books that are older than me to keep the sobriety. In terms of writing now, well, you know me. Usually when I start to write a book, I don't know if it will be a novel or novella or a play or a haiku poem. I really don't know. I wait until the book will decide. And usually I start with two or three different ideas, and I write them simultaneously as it is now. This is the phase where I am now. I write two stories in parallel to each other. They are not the same, they cannot be united. And the most important thing, I cannot decide which one of them I will write.
Okay.
If I decide, it will be like an arbitrary decision and they will not surrender. So I just have to continue to write both of them until one of them will charge and burst forward and will take me over. As I said, the inevitable books are the best books. So I'm waiting.
Last year, Hanse published your wonderful children's book, Giraffe und dann ab ins Bett. I don't dare to translate the German title. It's a book of good night stories you told your daughter Ruthie when she was a child. Do you also tell good night stories to your grandchildren?
Yes, not only that I tell them, they also write children's stories. They suddenly started to understand the pleasure of it. So the older one, who is 8 years old, she dictates to us, and some she writes herself, and she illustrates her stories with all kinds of nice drawings. And also the little one, who is 5 years old, also now started to understand that there is a special thing about telling a story or writing a story. And so I'm very active in this field now. I'm afraid it won't be published because they don't, as they say, they don't want to be famous. They are very clever girls.
But you can write the book together with them.
No, I don't. I want them to write it. I'm just the midwife. I just type it on the computer because it's their story. At a certain point, I will have to decide what I'm writing now. And you asked about the children books. It gives me really a lot of pleasure to write for children because I always think of the moments when these books are being read to the child, and it's a moment of intimacy, and the parents and the child are very close physically to each other, and the voice of telling a story is different from the usual voice we use for everyday life. And even the vocabulary is a little different. And in the stories can be humor, which not all the time is present in every house. And I think if you allow yourself to read the story almost as if it is read to you when you were a child, so you, the parent, and the child, you come equal to this bubble of the goodnight story. You both are tourists in it. And I have so many good memories from the time my father used to read to me. My father was now 93 years old, and he used to read to me. And I remember how it was exotic because not all the words I understood. But the words that I did not understand acted upon me for some nights afterwards. You know, they glue in the room. And I, well... I insist on continuing this tradition of reading for a child.
I think it can be helpful in this very moment, not only to you, but for many of us. So, dear David, thank you so much for this conversation and all the best.
Das war es für heute mit dem Podcast Hansa Rauschen. Das waren viele Worte für viele interessante Dinge. Bis zur nächsten Folge und danke fürs Zuhören.